A good afternoon to Europe, good morning to America, and probably good evening to Asia. Welcome to our second Areopa webinar. Today I have my former colleague and dear friend Jan Hoek with me as a moderator, and I will be your presenter. And yes, Jan, feel free to interfere. You're the only one whose mic will not be muted.
Okay.
So welcome. I have a topic which I dearly want to share, and which Jan is also, you could say, part of the story. As you know, I've been writing a book, or I've written a book, and has been published start of May on test automation. And one of the things we were working on at that time was building a PowerShell module, which would enable us to, looking at the title, getting easily from functional test definitions to automated tests. And we haven't been sharing it a lot. I saw that some people have been downloading the module, maybe because of the book, maybe because of a presentation I did on the Dynamics 365 Saturday session in Amsterdam last May it was, and people were quite enthusiastic about it. And yeah, so I thought, let's make a webinar of that. First, a couple of housekeeping rules, the normal ones. As said, your mic is muted. If you want to post questions, put that in the GoToWebinar question window. Jan will pick them up and will interfere in my presentation to ask the question and get me answer your question. So that's basically, you could say, the house rules. Social media wise, I think I shared a wrong link in the previous webinar, but this is the right link to our YouTube channel, the Areopa webinars, our YouTube channel, as written in small letters below. At the moment, it's not a very user-friendly URL, but as soon as we have three recordings, this will be the second, we will have the possibility to apply for a user-friendly URL. But we will also put on Twitter, communicate that the recording will be on YouTube. Next to that, if you haven't subscribed to our newsletter, please do, and ask others to do too. Upcoming webinars, you will see in one of the next slides, but they're always listed on our website. And yes, please spread the word. Coming from NAS Skills into Areopa, we still don't have yet the same audience subscribe to our newsletter. So spread the word. And yes, a big thanks to our sponsor, who is hosting us every time with the GoToWebinar functionality. So we're very great that they're helping us out. Upcoming webinars, we have already three programmed for fall, you could say, or late summer. On September 3, we will have the Russian MVP Dmitry Katsun presenting on the use of Python Azure Functions. On September 17, we will have James Pearson, the guy who's lately blogging a lot around building apps using Azure DevOps, etc. And he will be presenting his, well, experience so far. And the last one planned at the moment, but we're in discussion and talks with various people. And by the way, feel invited if you have topics yourself to contact us, or if you know somebody who would like to present a certain topic, please contact us. On October the 1st, we will have Tobias Fenster, our German MVP, and he is one of his favorite topics, discussing about the use of containers, and in this case, together with Azure VMs. So if you haven't subscribed yet, on our website, you will find links, and they have also been shared. And did I share it last Saturday, I think, in the newsletter. So be welcome to subscribe to them. And as said, we're working on more. There are more to come. But for today, we're going into a part where I would like to show you a couple of things on, given a number of test case definitions, how to easily get into coding them. I was working on that when I was writing my book, I'm working on that daily, but especially on the book. I did a lot of things. I had to, I think, because of mistakes or whatever, or wanted to check things, I had to re-code my test. And yes, it's quite a lot of work if you're only get a definition of the test. So you need to do this and this, and eventually have to check a couple of things. There's a structure for that, and I'll get to that during the session also. But I first wanted to dive into a part of myself, of course. If you haven't met me or whatever, here's a short resume of me and let's say my life, recent life. And some of you, and you too, Jan, you were part of this journey too, especially the 6 years that I was a software development engineer in test at Microsoft, yep. Which is a major background for this whole story, where we did our testing for the localization. I was working on localization only manually. We were working on automation, but that was just a start. And eventually the technique behind changed dramatically. So getting from fully manual test case definitions and execution, nowadays we're better set to get them automated and make them reusable. Part of this experience is also the one on the right bottom side. I'm more than 6 years working at the Learning Network, where we have been starting to implement the uses of automated testing a little over 3 years ago when we had upgraded to NAF 2016. And yeah, a lot of other things tell a bit about myself, but let's not spend too much time on that. And if you want to know more, feel free to call me somehow. As I said, recently, I've written a book. Eventually, I did, after so many years. I actually already had the plan about 8 years ago, where, let's say, when the testability framework was not that long out, and when I thought this has to be picked up. Well, time has learned that I wasn't the right time, apparently. Pact at that time didn't want me to write a book. I offered them to do that. But last summer I thought, now is the time to do. And yes, a lot of things are now eventually moving on this. So let's go into the topic of today. Getting easily from, and then the assumption is that you have test case definitions written, that they have, so test cases defined. I explicitly did put functional test cases, although that's not the restriction in the end. I'll probably will point that out later. And if not, feel free to ask. But it's all about, once there are tests defined, and not just somebody, like many in our ecosystem, many of our colleagues doing the tests manually sit down and from their experience and high involvement maybe into the new feature that is being built, they know what to do. This is about this, let's say the starting point is that those tests that they would be performing have been written out. And I think this is a basic thing that should be done anyway. In my book, and I'm not going to elaborate more on that, in my book I describe how what I call a customer wish or the requirements, how you could use a test case definition, a formal description of a test case, a format to describe your customer wish, and from there go into test and coding and test coding. So if you want to know more background of the story today, yeah, if you don't have my book yet, get it if you have it, and start reading it. The ones who have been reading the book might recall that I have a business case which I called the lookup value, or the lookup value case. It is a generic, you could say a generic addition, meaning adding a field, a lookup value code field to the customer table, and that lookup value stands for anything which makes sense functionally. And the whole thing is that this field should be carried over through the whole process of sales, you could say, through sales documents, like on the down left side here, the sales document and sales archiving into the post-it part. I'm not going to elaborate on the whole test case. I'm only going to use this simple part for today and show you what I want to show. It's not about the case as such, but we need an example. Actually, I had a totally different example, which was also a neat one, and I wanted also to have another one, not to repeat, but around lunchtime today, I found out actually that in Business Central, the code had changed that much that my nice example wouldn't make much sense anymore. So I decided to revert to this one. The advantage is that if you have the book, this relates to things told and elaborated on in the book. So what are we going to do, or what do we have? I have already built application code that extends the customer table with this field, which is has a table relation to a new table here in the middle of the diagram, a lookup value table. And so you can use that, create a lookup value record there, and let's say populate that lookup value code field on the customer table with that. That's the simple scenario for today. And with this, I want to dive in as a short prologue. I'm going to show you how I, or without the PowerShell module we're going to look at today, how I would do this normally, let's say, without that PowerShell module. Given, and yes, that's the starting point, we have a formally described test case, so a test case definition, and it's in the what is called ATDD format. I'll elaborate on that on some next slides, but let's leave that for now. I think everyone can read this. The feature is that we have a lookup value on the customer, and UT stands for unit tests. I could leave that out for the discussion now, but that's how I put it in the book too, and I'll explain it there. The scenario is I want to actually test that I can assign a lookup value to a customer. Yeah, a simple scenario, you have that table with lookup values, you have this field on the customer with a table relation, does it do the job? Well, given a lookup value and given a customer, that's the what they call the test fixture. You need to define what is your starting point, what is the fixture of your, what's your environment where you start from. And in this case, we don't need much more. And what the customer is, there's not much more detail. So actually it tells you, I don't just need a customer. And what the customer is, well, technically there's a record in the customer table. That's it. When? Well, set lookup value on the customer. So when the user sets a lookup value on the customer, on that customer record, or by code we will be doing that, then we should be able to verify that this customer has a lookup value code field populated. It's a simple one, and that's a unit test. And there are more variations. And yes, this is not the most difficult one, and maybe you could even discuss, is this really a functional one? I already said it's actually more about test cases and whether it's a functional test or a unit test. For me, as a tester, in the end, you could say, I don't care. For a developer, me also being a developer, yes, unit test is something a developer should come up with in general. But okay, I'm not going to dive into that discussion. So we have this simple scenario. And I'm going to show you, based on what I describe in the book as a four steps recipe, how I would implement giving that scenario that into a test code unit. I'm going to show you that in VS Code, so AL, and building an extension with that. And basically what I do is what I have four steps for. I call it create, embed, write, and construct. Create, the sentence is actually create a test code unit. Embed, the test case definition, the one we saw on the previous slide. Write a test story, and I'll elaborate a little bit on that while I'm doing that, and it's also described in the book. And construct the real code. So you can see there's and every time again when somebody would say, if you're a developer, provides you with test case definitions. I've got one now. I had one discussed on the slide, but I probably will have a collection of 10 or 20 or 50 or 100, whatever. And I need to implement each of them more or less based on this step-by-step method. So let me demo that. So here I have, I will open up my, and I've got it and on the other screen, but I will open up in VS Code, and I hope it opens up in the screen you're looking at. I did prepare a couple of things. I'm not going to do everything fully from scratch. And let me zoom in a little bit so it's better readable for anybody with or without glasses. Shortly, anybody who has been working with AL recognize a lot of things. If you haven't, I'm not going to discuss everything here, but basically I need to discuss a couple of things. First of all, I have a definition of a table lookup value with the needed fields. And with that, or for that, I have created a page or based upon that. That's that. That was that one in the middle of the diagram. Then I've created a table extension on the customer table where I have a lookup value code field with, as you can see, a table relation to that lookup value table. And I've also built a page extension for the customer list to have that field on the list, and for the customer page to have that field on it. It's not rocket science. We will have a look at it and see how it works. But mainly we will be focusing on the tests. And here I have, I now have set up a folder with app being app code and test being test code. And as you can see, I already created a test code unit folder, but there's nothing in it yet, because that's what I'm going to show you right now. How would I implement this? There's one tool you could say I'm using, and I've also been using in the book, and I've been using that in the past also as my way of setting up, or let other people set up in a somewhat structured and a bit supported way of structure supported way of, for people to create test case definitions. And this is how I start working with that, is an Excel sheet where I can define a feature, a scenario, the given when then part, and based upon some, let's say, simple formulas here, it will then create this right part. So I only need to fill this. As you can see, if I empty this, it will update the cells right from it. Well, let's undo that. And this gives me, you could say, the scenario outcommanded, everything placed behind double slashes, which allows me to copy and paste this thing. So that's how I went about creating everything in the book, and up to then creating test cases for, let's say, the projects I've been working on. So what do I need to do? Getting back to the slide first, I need to create a test code unit. So let's do that first. So if I want to code tests, I need to create an object file here. I'm just going to call it c.al. I could call it anything, and I'm going to create a code unit using a snippet. I'm going to use the standard snippet, and my code unit will have an ID in the range I already defined, 70,000, and I will give it the name being the name of my feature, and it was called lookup value unit test customer. So yes, the darn thing with the placeholders that I always forget those quotes, double quotes, but that's it. And basically, for test code units, the rest I don't need. What I need to create here, first of all, I need to make sure that this is a test code unit. So those who have been working with test code units, but maybe also with upgrade code units or install code units for extensions, a code unit has a subtype. The default value is normal, which is logical, and it has one of the types is test. So basically now I've created a test code unit. By the way, the name of the file is not reflecting the content, and I'm, well, mostly using then the CRS functionality of renaming a file, and it will then, based upon the input, as you can see, create a new name for this file. So I'm never bothering myself with typing rightly in the right way the name of this AL file. I'm calling it C or Luke or you or me or whatever. I don't care. So I've created that test code unit. So that's the first step. The second step is going to embed the test case definition. Well, that means I need to create a test function, because that will be my container for a test case. So that's the first thing I need to do. I need to create a function, T procedure, for those who have been programming in AL, and it always needs a tag called test in front of it. Yeah. So let me put an extra line in between. Yes, I don't need at this time any variables. And my function is the function that's going to test whether I can assign, let's look up value to customer. And yes, making typos, that's one of the things that will show you later on why I wanted this tool, which, as everybody has written the things right, I don't need to copy or really copy or copy it by typing it. I can let the tool do that. But let's have a look here. So I need to embed this. I already put this whole scenario here in a ATDD format. So let's copy this, and now I will embed this here. So that's actually already a nice efficient way of doing this. I don't need to read this. And what I always say, this is what functional people should be doing, not you as a developer. Maybe you're a functional person listening to this, but as a developer, and I'm talking specifically about creating the test code, as a developer, you should not write this. Well, unit test is a different story, but let's leave that. Basically, what I also say always is, if you don't have this green, you should never write the black. Only write tests, test functions, if you have a test definition for it. Okay, so I have a test definition embedded, and now I need to, what I call, and let's go back to the slide, what I call write the test story. If you're in, let's say, natural language programming, it means actually with app coding also, write your app story, your code in a story. Never, that's what I try to do, strive to never write code, start immediately like customer.insert or whatever. No, write a function that tells what it should be doing. So I need a function that creates a lookup value. Yeah. So like this. And next to that, the next step I need is, I see, by the way, that I have forgotten to copy something. I'll do that later. I need to have the next part of my story. I need to create a customer record. Yeah. And then I need to set the lookup value. You see, I'm a bad typer. Set the lookup value on customer. Yeah. One thing I did forget to copy is that I need to have a then part. And apparently I forgot, you see, I forgot to include that in my copy action. Then what do I need to do? I need to verify something like, I can just type the text or as is defined in the then part. So verify customer has look up value code field populated. The advantage of doing it this way is that it describes exactly what it is doing. You could argue about the length of the function name. And yes, implementation in the book, I did it a little bit shorter. I like to be crisp and short if I can, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that now. Basically, I've now written out what should be happening code-wise. I need to have functions, create lookup value, create customer, set lookup value, customer, very, etc., etc. So that there I will implement the real code. So this is what I call write the test story. And if I don't have a story, but start immediately coding the real code, you make your tests lesser, let's say lesser a platform, a forum of discussion. As soon as you dive into technical matters, straight away, you lose half or maybe more, or maybe a bit less of your functional team members, being your functional consultants, the key users you are working with. This way, you can still discuss with anybody what should be done. Sit down with your functional colleague and say, okay, so this is what you, and this is what I make of it. Does it make sense? Yes, it makes sense, or maybe not. This is the third step. And the fourth step, we need to go and construct the real code, which means for each of those sentences you could say in the story, I need to go and construct a real function. Unfortunately, in VS Code, maybe there is one in between. I'm not that up to date, I must confess, but it would be great if you could right click and say create function, which is common in environments as Visual Studio with C#, etc. But what I would be doing now is here start creating local functions or procedures that will enable me to start writing the code. Yeah, I'm not going to write everything down here. I have a kind of cheat sheet, a cheat file, I call it. And here, the cheat file, I'm going to put into my project outside of the screen you are looking at, but I've numbered it a little bit different. As you can see, it has now been added here. Apparently, I had forgotten to put lookup value here in, but this is version 2.1. Sorry, that was the first cheat sheet. I have a version 2 here. So it would mean that it ends up in getting a create lookup value code, I called it in the book, which will implement the creation of a lookup value record and return the code. It will create a customer, by the way, making use of the create customer function in the standard library, the sales, the helper functions library, which goes with the test tool of Microsoft, which has a lot of functions, and I always try to use this basis. I'm always doing and using the same. I have the function for the set lookup value on customer and a verification function. So basically what I've been doing is based upon this definition, which I had as a start, I started copy pasting, writing, constructing, and ending up with a code unit having everything right there. Yeah. So what happens if I remove this one? Let's have a short view on it. Let's see if we can build it. And just to be very instructive, I always remove the app file, and let's see if I can build it. Yes, the package is built. Can I deploy it? Then we can see what it's doing. It's not a lot, of course. It's just a simple one. So it should be opening up the web client somewhere. Hey. Okay, move it here. And it opens up with the test tool. I already added this test code unit to it, and now I could run it. And yes, you could wonder, is this the same test code unit behind? A simple test that is very instructive and very simple is, it will here verify if the right lookup value had been added. Well, let's just add a string look and then redeploy it again and rerun the whole thing. And then I didn't check that one today, but I'm quite You see, sure, that it now will tell me look is not the expected value. There's another value in that lookup value field. So yes, it's working straight, rightly doing what it should be doing. And if I go to, let's say the customer and have a look about at that field, is it, oh, sorry. Oh, what did I do wrong? I was too fast. I hadn't expect this one, but okay. Customers here. That's what I need, of course. So on the customers list, we will see that we have a lookup value code column. And if I go to cart of one of the customers, I will see that it's also been added to the fast app, the general fast app. All right. So a short prologue on how I would have been implementing my test code, and in this case with a simple scenario. Why would I wanted to show you something, and what is the problem we actually want to tackle with the next part of this demo or this webinar? Creating test code from test case definition in this way is a laborious task. You have to copy paste. Of course, the definition should be there. That's not part of the story here. It's error prone, me making typos, maybe forgetting to copy something as I just did, unintentionally, by the way, making reuse of helper functions. If we create functions like a local function called create customer, and I have different tests, making sure that every test would use the same helper function and that the helper function in the end is generic enough, etc. That might be a challenge. And the consistency in naming the functions might be an issue. So somebody has described a given and all of a sudden somebody programmed underneath the given a function with a name totally different, although it could be copy and paste more or less from the given description. So with this in mind, I asked Jan, you're a great PowerShell developer. No, don't make it smaller than it is. You are. and if you could help me on that, building this whole thing. You were quite fast in saying yes. And we had a small project running that on that. By the way, it's not fully finished yet, and it might be adding, we might be adding some new things based upon you guys, all of you listening and spreading the word and starting using it and coming up with new ideas. This part I would like to go into ATDD, so explaining that a little bit also, and then showing you how we implemented that into a PowerShell module, which, let's say, understands ATDD, the ATDD format. ATDD stands for Acceptance Test-Driven Development, and is actually a format that is defined close to users, how users do something. In the end, as you can see here, it is all about defining a given part, which is, as this on the right upper side, the context, the setup of the data. Where are you going to act? Where are you going to do an action which you want to test the result from? That given, in the end, you could use that also for unit tests, for any kind of test. You need to set up your environment in the right way that you will be able to do this next part, the when part. Exercise an action. An event is going to occur and it's going to do something in the system that will change it. And then the third part, you will verify the outcome of that. So that's what ATDD is about, and it's not rocket science. And there are also other formats, one I discuss in the book also, which is called the four-phase testing. It's actually about setting up data. The word setup is used for that first part. Exercising an action, that's the word used in the also here. Verifying the result, and there's a fourth phase called the teardown, cleaning up the system, bringing it back into the state it was, for example, when you started the test, or it needs to be before you start to execute the next test. test. This ATDT format is what I've been already using, as you saw. A small example on the next slide is a feature a little bit related to the whole feature I'm, let's say, landing a part of for today's demo. If you have a lookup value, it could be a field called label, which you could link to customers. And then with the posting, the label should then be handed up from, let's say, the unposted entities into the posted entities. So the scenario is, if you have a posted warehouse shipment, it should inherit the label from a sales order when the customer was added to through the warehouse shipment line. So given a location, that's what you typically need if you're going to work with warehousing and warehouse shipments, and that location should have a required shipment on. Given that you have an employee for the one who's executing the warehouse employee, and a warehouse shipment line with a label created from a sales order, when we're going to ship that shipment, warehouse shipment, it should end up, that label value should also end up on the posted warehouse shipment. So we're not going to use this scenario, but this is also a kind of scenario. This is surely more a user scenario related something. And it also always will be given when then. You could have multiple givens, multiple thens. You could need to verify a couple of more things. There will always be one action when. So if you want to learn more, there's a link here in my book. There's more about it on Microsoft's site, the docs.microsoft for Business Central. There is also descriptions on this. And the code would become something like this, which is recognizable for those who have been writing code using this format already, or based upon, let's say, what I showed you a couple of minutes ago with my, let's say, prologue. So ATDD test script, actually Jan built it. I did more or less designed it. A PowerShell module which allows you to create in a readable manner your scenarios and convert that using this ATDD test script. Well, it's also already used to build up your scenarios. It recognizes keywords and a structure. And based upon that structure, which we call a feature with scenarios in it, multiple scenarios, it will convert that all into an AL test code unit. So in my book, I made reference to this already, although we hadn't finished it at that moment, but on the PDF on page 145 in the printed book, the numbering is a little bit out of sync with this one. I already mentioned this one, and the purpose here is that it enables this module enables you to convert test case definitions straight into AL test code unit. Having said that, it actually tackles the three steps, the three part first parts out of that four-step recipe. It tackles the creation of a test code unit. It tackles the embedding of the test case definition into a test function, and it writes the test story for you, including the creation of functions that, let's say, set are defining the test story. The last step, constructing the real code, is partly done by creating functions already for you, but the content of those functions, that's up to the developer. But basically, it takes out a lot of work out of the hands of a developer already. So, and that's what I'm going to show in the next demo. There are a couple of prerequisites. You need PowerShell 4. Whatever. And Jan, you were still checking if you could do it also with PowerShell Core.
It works in PowerShell Core as well. So okay. PowerShell 4 and up, I would say.
Yeah, with PowerShell 4, I think we had an issue, but verify it.
Oh, maybe 5 and up then.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, so you need that to have been installed on the machine you're working on. In Visual Studio Code, you need to have the PowerShell extension added to it. And yes, on your machine, you do need to have installed the test, the ATD, the test scripter module, which you can find, the link is here, on the PowerShell gallery. At the moment, we're on version 007. There is some work to be done. There are four open issues, and one is surely assigned to me. I started to, but it's already a month or so ago, I worked on it last time, writing or completing the documentation. It's not yet fully completed. There is already a part on, but that's one of the reasons why we're not at version one. So you can find it on the PowerShell gallery. By the way, you will find here a project site link. I will get to that in a later slide. The code you can find on a GitHub project, and feel free to be part of that if you want.
As well as the installation instructions, I think we should.
Sorry?
I said, as well as the installation instructions, I think we should mention they're also on GitHub.
Yeah.
In the README.
Yeah. And there are also some examples of how to use it, etc. So it's nearly complete, you could say. Some things missing on the specific parameter description. I'll get to them also in some slides. Let me demo this one. And for that, I will be closing down this project, VS Code project, and I will be opening up. Let me have a look. It's somewhere on this level. I'll be opening up another project. It contains the same application code, but it already has a folder called what I called ATDD scenarios. There are no test code units. And the whole thing behind is that, and by the way, I did not mention yet, but PowerShell extension has been installed in my Visual Studio client here already. The whole idea behind this is I want to have a file, actually more or less just a text file, but let me call it lookup value unit test customer.ps1. So it will be a PowerShell file. And in this PowerShell file, I will be able to define a feature. And as you can see, feature is a recognized keyword, which is there because of that ATDD test scripter module. And a feature needs to have a description, single quotes. And typically it would be this feature name, which I also had in that Excel sheet, and I could copy and paste it from there. Actually, this is work which should be done by functional people and could be written in exactly this format. And then a developer doesn't need to copy and paste anything from that. But let me now type a little bit, and it needs to have a structure defined by the curly brackets. And in the structure, I will have the possibility to define a scenario. A scenario typically will have a number and a description. And in our case, it will be a scenario called assign. But let's say I'm a real developer, I'm somewhat lazy. So what I can do is copy and paste things from here. I could even do it like this, copy and paste, and then start reorganizing things somewhat here, meaning I need to have a description for my scenario, and each scenario is also a structure of a number of given when then. So here I need to have a given when then, and you can see there is no red wrinkle, so it recognizes everything. The only thing is typically this needs to be strings. So in single quotes, I'm just typing a quote and confirming it more or less with a space. And this is my ATDD test scenario, similar to the other one. But then I need to convert this. And for the conversion of this, I have a file. I will add that now to the ATD scenarios folder, and it will appear here. And that's this one. This is describing the conversion using the commandlet convert to AL test code unit with a number of parameters, and it will be outputting it to my test subdirected test code units called this way. And what I need to do here is run F8, and typically I get an error I didn't have before. So let me.
Yeah, I think your script is called something else now.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, that's the. Yeah. So let me do it simple like this. Thank you. That your ear, Jan.
Yeah, sure. Anytime.
So let me wait. That was this one here. So yeah. So I'm going to use that here, like this one. So oh no, on the other one. And it has now created. It was not there. I can rerun it again, by the way. So that's also one of the things that makes this one very variable, that you think that's not right yet. Rerun it. So it recreates a test code unit, and as you can see, gdang. Well, a bit too much. Let's put this down here, or let's do it like this. So it creates based upon my feature name here. The code unit name I've defined myself explicitly, but based upon the scenario name, it creates a function. What it does, it removes spaces. Every single word gets an uppercase starting character. And as you can see here, the given uses this string too, but there's something added. I'll get to that. And set lookup value and customer is created later. But it's not only, let's say, writing the story, as I call it, it's also already doing the first step in constructing the real code. As you can see, there is a function, create a customer, create a lookup value. And if I have multiple scenarios with create a customer, it will only create one function called create a customer. I'm not finished here because we need to do the technical part, going down into the functions. There are a couple of things I want to discuss first, but as you can see, it's just one single, in this case, F8, doom. It creates my whole test code unit, giving me as a developer the structure in which I can start programming. Getting back to my, PowerShell script, you could call it here, I've got a couple of parameters, and I'll discuss them on the slides also. But typically, this one is adding something as extra, initialize function. As you can see, there is an initialize function created in my test code unit. And for those who have been working with test code unit, this is for the shared fixture. I'm not going into details, but if I don't want it, let's close this one and let's rerun it, and it will then rebuild that code unit. I'll remove this and rerun this, and then we will see I will not get an initialize function. That's one thing. Next to that, given a customer, that's what you say, what is the action you technically want to do? I want to create a customer. I could even argue the word is maybe not that much wanted. So what I do here is, given, I could just describe it like this, lookup value, be short and understandable enough. That will remove the in my function also. And I could also, not that I want to add create, if I leave this out, it does not add create to my function name, but I could also call it generate, whatever, if that fits me better. So if I rerun this again, it will now have a function called generate lookup value. Is gone. The same applies to the then part. I can create, this is actually a structure. So this is the placeholder for the then part. And anything I add in front or behind it will be then concatenated with that string. So in a very short action, instead of having to copy and paste and type a lot of things, I can just get this from my functional people or the testers or whatever that have been defined, and with a more or less push of the button, it creates for me as developer a base structure where I then can start programming the real thing inside. Okay. Don't know if there are any questions so far, by the way, Jan.
Yeah, well, one has just come in. Erik Wouters asks if it's if it also updates an AL file.
No.
And I don't think we have that yet.
We have that. We don't have that yet. It, it would be, well, that would be a bit more complex. So at the moment, and it's, it, thanks for asking, Eric, and it's a relevant one. This was at the moment the easiest thing and the most important to do. Yes, it would be great that you could turn it the other way around. And I ran into, let's say, that pitfall myself working on a major feature at the learning network where the tests, automated tests, were of big help. And I set up the test cases, discussed them with my product owner. And while moving on, we found out there were a couple of glitches there and we needed to get the test working, and they were already in a quite advanced state that we could not go back to the test scripts anymore. So in the end, yes, the ATD test definitions, so those PowerShell files are code too, and they were part, they're part of our code repository, but I deleted them because updating them at that time was too much. So we need to find a way to go back, and that would be going into the code, like going into those different parts, extracting them and converting them back into a text, which looks more or less like this. But we haven't done that yet.
Yeah, and of course, your primary idea was to provide functional people with a almost a domain specific language in which they can describe their intentions, right?
So and then getting that into
that's where it starts. Yes.
Exactly. Yeah, the both things were there, huh? Getting the thing you described and getting that easily into code.
Into code, yep. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so, another question from Eric. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
What about multiple tests per code unit? Can you reuse functions?
So let's do it like this, simply. So making up a little bit now. Not maybe a straight a good scenario, but let's say we're just calling this number two, yeah? And let's, for this function, we need to have another name, but let's call this underscore two or two, whatever, yeah? So if I would run this now, I have not coded anything yet, you would see that this code unit will now have two test functions, and both will have generate customer, and if I go to the I only have one function called generate customer. So that's part of the reusability. Don't know if that exactly answers your question, but that's one part of it. And yes, if you would be having helper functions inside this and reuse it, that's up to you as a developer. But basically, the ones more or less that have been defined by the different tags, the different given, when, then tags. If it finds a same sentence, it will create, of course, the, let's say, this black part as part of the story in exactly the same way up here and down here. And based upon that, it will only create one function. Yeah, a local helper function. Okay. Any other questions, John?
Think so. I think that's all. Yeah.
Okay. So moving to the next slide. This is the syntax. This is also described in the module and some documentation on the different parameters. I'll show it on the next slide. An example which we also have on the GitHub is if you would do it in one line, that you would define a feature with a structure having a scenario, with a structure having its given when then part, and then pipe that into the call of the convert to AL, and that will then create all things. Let's say that this is in what you would have in one PowerShell statement, more or less. But of course, this first part before the piping is what I showed you in putting that into a PowerShell file, which you then, read in using this structure here. the different parameters, you have to define a code unit ID and a code unit name. You have to define one way or the other by referencing to a file or explicitly defining a feature, which is more or less a kind of structure, of course. It's having multiple or single scenarios, by the way. In a feature file, you could also define multiple features and get them into one code unit or different code unit if you want to. This parameter initialize defines that initialize function, and then we have the three parameters given function, where you could say this is the format of the given any given element, this is the format of any when element, and this will be the format of any then element. Yes, we're getting to the hour, we're almost there. On GitHub, I didn't put a screenshot there, but on GitHub you will find a project here with some demo examples, etc. And of course, as I said, we have four open issues, partly because of how we get things tested ourselves for and get them built. But this one surely about completing the documentation and reviewing a couple of things, we still have to do that. But if you want to be part of this, be very welcome. If you start using it and have issues, put them on, and let's see if we can tackle them for you soon enough. Actually, I'm done. Thanks for being here. And yes, if there are questions, we have a couple of minutes left to the hour, so feel free to post them. And as long as nothing coming up, Jan.
Not yet. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
No. I think everything's clear, and some people are quite positive about it. So that's good to hear.
Yeah, it's great to hear. I mean, I've been profiting of this already myself quite a lot of times. But like with many things I'm doing, the more people that can start using this, let's say, the bigger the fun. So the links are on the slides. You will get access somehow, surely through YouTube. If you want to contact me, well, you will find different ways, either through Twitter or LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever. Feel free to ask. And of course, on the project sites, there is also contact information. You can report issues on the GitHub project. So there are multiple ways of getting in contact with us. Jan, is there something you think that I maybe forgot to discuss?
No, I don't think so. No.
Well, then we're done before the hour.
Well done. Yeah.
Jan, well, thank you very much to you too.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank to everybody having been here, and we're going to close down.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.